Actually, in our school, we had come up with an idea of sensing, like if food, inside the food packets, if food has been spoiled, we wanted to know it with the use of senses. And actually, we went in a, like, in a chemical way. So we wanted some paper slips or something so, which will react with the like air, whatever is there inside, and people come to know that the food is spoiled or not. So, but we had a question in our mind, that is, there are like different kinds of food, like oil items, non-oil items, many things. So, we thought that many different types of sensors are needed for the detection. So, can we have a sensor which can sense the spoiling for any type of food? One common sensor. Can we have?
Very, very nice question. Thank you for asking it. That's actually the key for why photonic sensors are better than other types of sensors. And the reason is, if you look at oil, you look at dairy, you look at poultry, you look at fish, all of these have different chemicals that come out when food is spoiled, right? There may be some common features, like, for example, you may get H2S, you know, smell from some spoiled food. And that can be helpful in detecting across the board, H2S. However, if you want specificity for each chemical that is there when tomatoes are spoiled, or milk is spoiled, or fish is spoiled, then you need a photonic sensor that gives you the fingerprint of that particular chemical that is released when that food is spoiled. And that is what a huge amount of research is actually being done in that area today. People want to know what kind of chemicals should we be detecting. There are a lot of fishermen from across the world who have come to us and asked us, we catch the fish far away from shore. By the time we bring it from where we catch it to the shore and dump it on ice, some of the fish is already spoiled. Can you sell us some low-cost way to detect which fish is spoiled so we can dump it back in the ocean and not carry it all the way and detect it too late? So that's a very, very important point. How to detect different elements. And photonic sensors will be the answer in the longer term, I think. Other questions? Any questions? Yes.
We have it at MIT now.
What
stage?
It, yeah, what stage? Is it at a prototype stage?
Yes,
is it
yeah.
as a product stage?
Product
or
stage.
Where is it? Very interesting. So typically at MIT, in my lab, what we do is research. So we try to come up with innovative ideas. We try to come up with ways in which we can sense different chemicals, the ways in which we can improve response, the ways in which we can suppress noise. All of these are ideas that we come up with. Then what we do is we discuss these ideas with companies. And we have something in MIT called the Industrial Liaison Program, where there's a whole set of people who are involved in bringing company interests back to campus. So companies who are looking for sensors, like the fish sensors that I talked about, those companies come to Industrial Liaison Program, and they say, what are you looking for? What problem are you trying to solve? Says, oh, we have fishermen going out to sea. We want to know whether the fish that they bring back is fresh. So can you tell us anyone on campus who can help? They bring those problems to us, and then we say, yes, we can find a solution. If that company and us make a partnership, then we build a prototype. And once we build a prototype, if the company is very satisfied with the results of the prototype, then they take it to the next level, which is manufacturing a product. So that's the usual sequence of events. In our case, right now, we're still at the very basic, I would say, between research and prototype level. We are just making prototypes. And in our lab, we're also trying to package it. Because, I mean, this is understated all the time. We always talk about research and how wonderful all these ideas are, but we never mention how much the cost is involved in packaging these sensors. That's 90% of the cost is in packaging. So if somehow you can find a clever way to package such that it is reliable and it's low cost, you'll win some prize somewhere for sure. This is a very big problem in science today.
Reliability is the most important.
Reliability after packaging.
Packaging, yes.
Especially for sensors, because sensors are quite unique. You take a chip, you wrap it up, you package it, it's sealed inside your, let's say you have an iPhone, it's sealed there. If you drop it in water, okay, it may function for a while, it may die. But we need sensors that are open to the environment. So they're very vulnerable. They need to see the moisture, they need to see the chemicals, but yet they need to not get spoiled. So this is why packaging of sensors are very, very different from other type of packaging. And it's very costly at this time.
One more small question.
No.
What is the level of funding you get for this? You get from government or from the industry?
That's very, very helpful question. Research funding goes by in waves. So sometimes people are suddenly interested in sensors, and sometimes there's not much interest in sensors. However, what we found is that for basic science, answering basic science, places like National Science Foundation is always interested. But recently we found that companies are coming forward through these programs like industrial liaison programs. Companies are coming forward and finding researchers and saying, we will fund you for 3 years. We will fund your students to do this project. Can you find some students who are interested and who are good, and they will stay with this problem until you find a solution, say 3 years, 5 years. So master's program, undergraduate, we even fund undergraduate students, undergrad, master's and PhD programs in order to find a solution to the industry problem.
Thank you very much.
Continuation of that earlier question, do you see an IR spectroscopy which would can be miniaturized, and can we integrate that with the smartphone so that you know?
It's been done. At a prototype stage,
okay,
by a company in Israel, and also there's a company in the US that has done it, but they only can detect few chemicals. And also, they use near IR light. Near IR light is good, but if you go further into the infrared, mid-infrared, and far infrared, your chemical fingerprint is much better, much stronger. So we are trying to make this, but move into the mid-infrared. So that's the best idea.
Okay,
everybody's looking to do that. Everyone wants their smartphone to be able to tell me whether there's pollution in the air. Like in Delhi, it's going to be very useful, right? Should I go out today or should I not go out? You just put your cell phone up in the air and it'll tell you.
Yeah, I had just another application that when I go to a hotel, I want to see what kind of ingredients I have, whether to take it or not.
Yes, yes. In fact, that's also very useful. For example, if you're vegetarian and you want to know that this does not have any meat products in it, that's another way to make sure. Or is there any pesticide? Or is there any is it organic or not?
Thank you.
Yeah. So I'd like some more questions from the kids back here. Yeah, go ahead.
Ma'am, what if two gases mixes, then what do photonic sensor do?
Okay, very, very good. You guys have really been awake. I'm very impressed. Okay. So what do you do when there are a mixture of gases? That's $1 million problem. Because if you have a mixture, you have to have, let's say you have methane and propane together. Now, both of them have CH bonds in them, correct? But in many cases, there are other wavelengths at which propane absorbs, but methane does not absorb, or vice versa. So what you have to do is look at the full spectrum. This is why when Professor asked about whether it's only one wavelength or it's a band of wavelengths, I mentioned that we have a band of wavelengths. So methane has a very characteristic signature, which we call the fingerprint. And now methane's fingerprint is detected propane's fingerprint is detected, and that's how we can tell that in the mixture of gases, we have two elements. We have methane and we have propane. And based on the signal of each wavelength, we can tell how much propane and how much methane. So this is why photonic gas absorption techniques are very, very helpful in determining sensitivity and specificity. If you go out of this lecture room knowing just two things about sensors, and that is sensitivity and specificity are desirable, I'll think I did a good job in explaining what I came to explain. So those are two features of sensors. You have to know what is there, you have to know how much is there. Okay. Other questions, thoughts? No? Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. You've been a great audience.